Now I'm going to show you guys something. It's one of those things that just they really affect me, I have to admit. I mean, I get the prickle on the back of the neck. You know, sometimes these things put me in tears. Maybe they do you too. I don't know. I want to show something now that's going to make you just marvel at God. I want you to picture in your mind the geometry of a lunar eclipse. It's not really very hard. You just have the sun and the earth and the moon, and they line up. The earth gets between the sun and the moon and blocks the light. Okay, so they're lined up. When you look at a lunar eclipse from Earth, the moon gets dark. But if you were to go to the moon and look back, what would you see? You'd see the Earth coming between you and the sun, wouldn't you? You'd see a solar eclipse, wouldn't you? Okay, because that's the reverse. So I'm going to do something now that I think you'll find interesting. We're now on the moon. You're standing on the moon. You're looking back towards the sun. And that's the Earth. I want to show you now the moment of Christ passing on the cross. That's 3 p.m. That's Aries, the Paschal Lamb, the Ram, the constellation Aries, at the very instant of Christ's death. I'll show you again. He is expiring right now. And the heart of the ram is put out. Jesus, your Paschal Lamb. This evening, as you're kind of digesting what you've seen here today, let yourself think about what this says about God, about the level of structure that he built into the universe to announce the coming and passing of our Messiah.
Now we need to date Christ's execution. The reason we have to do that is otherwise we won't know to look at the sky. We need to know what day we should study the sky to see the end of this poem that I'm showing you. So we have clues. First, we know it was preparation day, and the Sabbath was about to begin. Okay, some of you may not know what preparation day means. Jews of this time, if they were observant Jews, could not work on the Sabbath, which was Saturday. They couldn't cook, couldn't wash clothes. So if they wanted to eat, they had to prepare it on Friday, and so Friday came to be called Preparation Day. So all four Gospels say that Jesus was killed on a Friday. Next clue. It was just before the Passover feast. That's super useful, because we know when Passover is. We find from Leviticus, the Lord's Passover begins at twilight on the 14th day of the first month. That's the Jewish lunar month of Nisan. The Jewish calendar is not a solar calendar like the one we use. So those three clues taken together are extremely powerful. And let me explain why. Because their lunar calendar works like our solar calendar in some ways, and this is one of them. Think about your birthday. It's always on the same day of the month, right? Is it always on the same day of the week? No, because in the solar calendar and the lunar calendar, days of the month can float through the days of the week. Our calendars are alike in that. But that's a clue. It's a huge clue, because now you can see Jesus must have been killed in a year when Nisan 14 happened to fall on a Friday. Can you see that? Okay, that really narrows things down. Let's get some more clues up there. Jesus himself is about 30 years old when he began his ministry. John recounts three Passovers during Christ's ministry. And we know he was taken before Pilate. And we know when Pilate sat, because Tacitus, the Roman historian, records it, 26 to 36 AD. So all these things taken together, plus more stuff on the website, come to one conclusion. Only April 3 of 33 AD seems to fit all the lines of evidence. This is the day of the cross.
April 3rd, 1968. In Memphis, Tennessee, civil rights leader Martin Luther King Jr. gives this speech on the night before his assassination.
We've got some difficult days ahead. But it really doesn't matter with me now, because I've been to the mountaintop.
You'll be able to tell your kids about how the U.S. dollar was once the strongest currency in the world, and you were there to watch it fall into ruin. You'll be able to explain to your kids that it was all self-inflicted, how arrogance, greed, and bullying led to the collapse. We'll get to that part of the story in a minute. But first, you'll also be able to tell your kids that you were there when they took away paper dollars and coins in favor of a U.S. digital currency. And you'll be correct, because in fewer than 24 hours, the United States dollar changes forever. Tomorrow, the first week of April, the Federal Reserve begins the rollout of their new central bank digital U.S. dollar. That's right. It's called the FedNow program, and it's going to replace your paper currency. Not overnight, but it's moving in that direction. And it will move the United States to a cashless society, a surveillance state where every transaction will be tracked and cataloged, where, as the Fed describes it, money that's in your account can even expire and become unusable. That's right, just like that Red Lobster gift card that you never used. One day you go and try to buy some popcorn shrimp and some Cheddar Bay biscuits, and the gift card doesn't even work anymore. Gone. You can read how the Fed plans to use the expiring money right on the Fed's website. China's already doing it. We already have a template for it. And many U.S. government museums, national parks, historical sites are no longer accepting paper dollars. Many of you have emailed me about this. You've tried to go and actually use dollars at different locations. Sorry, we don't accept cash. Want to go visit the Wright Brothers Museum? Don't bring cash. You'll have to use digital currency. Want to go to Smithsonian? Sorry, no cash. How about Mount Rainier National Park? Sorry, no cash allowed. We only accept digital. And many American businesses have already gone cashless as well. They'll pretend it's all about convenience, but really, you know, it's all about control.
One man he resists. One man.